Welcome and thanks for watching. In this video, we will be exploring the differences between dominant and recessive epistasis. The phenomenon of epistasis describes scenarios in which two different genes interact together to affect the same trait. And specifically, one gene acts to suppress the effects of another. In this scenario, for example, two different genes, gene A and gene B, interact to affect wing color, and gene A's expression works to suppress the effects of gene B. In epistasis, the gene whose expression interferes with or masks the effects of another's is known as the epistatic gene. So gene A is acting as the epistatic gene in this example. The gene whose expression is suppressed is known as the hypostatic gene, which is gene B in this example. As we can see from this interaction, the expression of one gene influences the effects of another, so these genes are not acting independently, and as a result, we see deviations from expected Mendelian ratios. Now that we understand what epistasis is, let's explore the two main types, dominant and recessive. In dominant epistasis, the dominant allele of one gene masks the expression of the alleles of another. This interaction produces deviations from normal Mendelian ratios, and specifically, we see a shift from the typical 9 to 3 to 3 to 1 ratio in dihybrid crosses to a 12 to 3 to 1. In cases where dominant epistasis is observed. In recessive epistasis, the recessive alleles of one gene mask the expression of the alleles of another gene, and we expect to see a 9 to 3 to 4 ratio of offspring phenotypes in a dihybrid cross where recessive epistasis is observed. Now these terms make more sense with some examples, so let's take a look. In this example of dominant epistasis, we see that genes A and B interact to affect fruit color. Alleles of gene B produce either yellow pigment in fruit if a dominant B allele is present, or green pigment in fruit if homozygous recessive B alleles are inherited. However, in the presence of a dominant allele at gene A, no pigment is produced at all, and we see that fruit pigment is white no matter what allelic combinations are present in gene B. Because the dominant allele of one gene, in this case gene A, hides the expression of alleles of another gene, gene B in this scenario, this is an example of dominant epistasis, and we can say that gene A is epistatic to gene B. One more feature that is worthwhile to note in this example is the ratio of offspring phenotypes being observed here. As we can see, we are no longer getting the 9 to 3 to 3 to 1 ratio typical of a dihybrid cross in which genes are working independently. Instead, we see a 12 to 3 to 1 ratio across phenotypes, which, as we learned, is characteristic of dominant epistasis. Now that we've got a grasp on dominant epistasis, let's take a look into recessive epistasis. In this example, we have genes A and C interacting to determine mouse coat color, with gene A encoding for either tan or gray pigments depending on whether a dominant allele is present. Gene C, on the other hand, is involved in pigment production, with a dominant C allele producing pigment, whereas homozygous recessive genotypes produce no pigment. In this scenario, gene A's effect is reliant on the genotype present at gene C, and this is made clear in the Punnett square, where we only see pigmented coat color in genotypes where at least one dominant C allele is present, and in cases where two recessive C alleles have been inherited, no pigment is produced and a white coat color results. In this scenario, because the recessive alleles of gene C mask the effects of the alleles at gene A, we would say this is recessive epistasis, and that gene C is epistatic to gene A. As a result of this recessive epistasis, we once again deviate from expected Mendelian F2 ratios and get a 9 to 3 to 4 ratio across offspring phenotypes. Now that we've got an understanding of what dominant and recessive epistasis are, let's try some practice problems to assess our knowledge. Imagine squirrel nesting behavior is determined by two genes. Only squirrels that are homozygous recessive with a GG genotype nest in trees, and all other individuals nest on the ground. Of the squirrels that nest in trees, individuals with a dominant B allele prefer to nest in pine trees, while squirrels that are homozygous recessive prefer maple trees. In a cross of two squirrels with heterozygous genotypes, what phenotypic ratio regarding nesting behavior will result in their offspring? This scenario is describing dominant epistasis, so we would expect to see a phenotypic ratio among offspring of 12 to 3 to 1. We can tell that this is dominant epistasis because in the event that a dominant allele is inherited at the locus of gene G, the effects of gene B are masked. In other words, because the presence of a dominant allele at gene G leads to ground nesting behavior, its effects nullify the phenotypes encoded for by gene B. Since squirrels with a dominant G allele nest on the ground, it doesn't matter whether gene B's alleles encode a preference for pine or maple trees, as we will not see these effects, leaving the expression of gene B's genotype masked by the expression of gene G's. How might this ratio change if instead only squirrels with a dominant G allele in their genotype nested in trees? If this question was instead phrased so that only squirrels with a dominant allele at gene G nest in trees, the ratio of offspring phenotypes in this dihybrid cross would be 9:3:4, and this would describe recessive epistasis. In this modified scenario, the recessive alleles at gene G would mask the effects of the alleles present at gene B. This is because recessive alleles would lead to ground nesting behavior, and because these squirrels nest on the ground, their tree nesting preferences would not matter, so gene B's effects would be rendered useless. With the recessive alleles of gene G hiding the effects of gene B, nesting behavior in squirrels would be dictated by recessive epistasis, and we would see a 9:3:4 phenotypic ratio in offspring. After exploring that example, I hope this video has been helpful in understanding the differences between dominant and recessive epistasis. Thanks for watching and have a great day.